Welcome to Better Sex, where you get the information and inspiration to create and enjoy your best possible sex life. Join your host, sex therapist Jessa Zimmerman, as she brings you expert guests, helpful tips, knowledge, and strategies to improve your intimate relationships. And now, your host, Jessa Zimmerman.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Better Sex Podcast. This is Jessa, and I'm so glad you're here with me, really especially today, because we're going to be talking about a really important topic, and it doesn't get enough attention, and that is male victims of childhood sexual abuse, child molestation. I am fortunate that my guest today, Dr. Stephen Braveman, had the time to spend with me on this topic because he really is the preeminent expert in the field, one of the early pioneers in working with this population. And, you know, we as a culture have a myth that boys aren't abused, or, you know, it just doesn't happen. It can't happen, or it doesn't affect them. No big deal. And that's not true. It happens way more than we'd want to believe. It has lasting impacts. It affects people, and help and healing is possible. But first, we have to start to identify and acknowledge the problem and then know what to do about it. So Stephen's here talking about all of the background about this field, all of the kinds of myths that we have as a culture, what goes into the healing journey for people. And it's just so, so important. Whether you know it or not, someone in your sphere may have been sexually molested. And it's going to be important to have this awareness for any day in which this comes up. Or, you know, maybe you or your partner has had this experience and this will be supportive. Anyway, I know you're going to take a ton from the show. And before we start the show today, it is sponsored by Intimacy with Ease. It's a method to help otherwise happy couples achieve a sex life that is easy and fun for both of them, so that you can actually just enjoy your sex life with zero stress. For more information, if you want to watch a brief little training video that's available, all of that, go to intimacywithease.com. So, Stephen, thank you so much for being on the show with me.
Oh, you're welcome. It's my pleasure.
This is an honor. You are the person in this field, so I'm delighted to talk to you. Can we start with sort of the history of the field and then, you know, I guess your place in it a little bit, too?
Absolutely. Well, I do work with women. I do work with transgendered people. I work with all kinds of populations, but I'm best known for my work nationally with men who have been sexually abused as children. Drop of the history there is back in our country in the 1950s or 60s, if a male had said he had been sexually abused, he most likely would have been put on antidepressants, antipsychotic medications. And if he persisted and said, no, I was sexually abused, he would have been put in a psychiatric hospital because people didn't believe that males could be sexually abused. Just wasn't the case. Then during the 1960s, when we as a country really started to make a dent on women who have been raped, not putting them on trial, saying, no, they're the victims, not the survivors. We started to look at the field of sexual abuse very differently and became more advocates as a country for the survivor. In the 1970s and 80s, we really moved towards working with not only women, but with children who have been sexually abused, specifically, though, girls. It was still not really spoken about that boys could be sexually abused, still not really believed. Then in the 1990s, I was asked by our local Monterey County Rape Crisis Center to start a men's group for guys who had been sexually abused as children. And they told me it was new. They had no idea how it would go, but they thought I was the best person to get it started. Let's give it a try. Got in, and 2 years of running the group, I heard of a new organization called the National Organization on Male Sexual Victimization. Thought, great, they're having an annual conference. Happens to be within 2 hours of my home. Good, I'm going to go. And I got there and I met other professionals and I started attending workshops and I was hoping to learn something And with 2 hours, I learned I was considered one of the leading authorities in it. Oh, my God.
Because you'd been doing this group for 2 years or something.
For 2 years, yeah. I had some experience. That's it.
Wow.
Well, I did learn that the same time that we started this very rare group, which now we've learned was one of the first four of its kind in the world and still is a very rare group. But when we started it, it coincided with an author named Mike Lew, and that's M-I-K-E-L-E-W. He came out with a book called Victims No Longer. And it was the first groundbreaking book on the subject about males being sexually abused.
Wow.
Prior to that, we had The Courage to Heal by Laura Davis and Ellen Bass for women. It had become like the Bible book to go to for female survivors. We had a lot of other people writing about female survivors. Prior to Mike's book, one of our ASEC members, Hani Maletsky, had written a book called Mother-Son Incest, but it didn't go anywhere. It didn't make a splash. Incidentally, since she has seen our documentary, she redid her book with the help of some of the guys from my group. And it's now a very viable, good book that I can highly recommend. But Mike Lew's book, finally we have something that guys could read and go, oh, wow, I was abused. Oh, yeah. Wow. There is a path forward. Oh, wow, I can do something about this. So I and other people who became leaders in the field started publishing on the subject, started giving lectures on it, started expanding these groups, and still found it pretty rare. Then what drove my place in the field really was when Michael Jackson years ago was accused of being a pedophile. It was quoted in the front page of our local newspaper by a woman who ran a local women's crisis center, that Michael Jackson had to have been sexually abused as a boy because, and she made this definitive statement, when boys are molested as children, they grow up to become pedophiles.
Wow.
I and the men in my group wanted to pull our hair out. We were like, oh my God, no. This is called the vampire syndrome, which is one of the top seven myths about male sexual victimization. And it's the most damaging one.
Yeah.
It's the one where people believe that if you were bitten, like Count Dracula bit his victims, you would go on to bite others. If you were molested as a male, you will become a pedophile. When I challenged her on the subject, she said, oh no, that was accurate. No, they didn't misquote me. And she really believed it. We said, that's it. We've got to educate the world. And so we decided to make a documentary. On our way to making the documentary, we made the first ever for TV commercial having to do with males being sexually abused and that there was help available. This was very groundbreaking, got a lot of national attention. But then we went on to do our documentary, a full-length movie called Boyhood Shadows, I Swore I'd Never Tell. It was very groundbreaking, the first of its kind in the world, a documentary on this subject, not a fun film. We don't have depictions of or reenactments of sexual abuse in it, but we have 20 guys in the film who have been sexually abused as children, 18 of them who had worked with me directly, and a few others that the filmmaker went on and found, which was really good. They tell some of their story, but they also have their mothers, their fathers, their brothers, their sisters, their wives, their children, they're in the movie, and we talk about this subject. Katie Kirk makes a guest appearance in our documentary, and so does one of the most infamous sex offenders, child molesters in California, a man named James Lamb, who had been serving time in prison for molesting over 75 boys over a course of years, and he was coming out of prison, and we were being asked over and over again, is he safe to be in the community? So this topic just exploded wide open. People were very interested in it. As I mentioned earlier, books started coming out about it, and other people started making documentaries. And good, we made a mark.
Yeah.
So that was really big. And I tell this story for many different reasons. One is to give a little bit of the history, but also to mention, while it was real big, it is a topic that gets dropped like a hot potato
right
anytime anything else comes up. So 4 years of Trump being in office, the COVID virus being around, a war, and people totally forget that there's a topic here. Now, of course, there's other important topics in the world. I mean, the Me Too movement was really helpful and wonderful. Right. I'm glad to be an advocate for that as well. But it's important for this topic to come back to it occasionally to make another point. Hello, there are still guys out there who are suffering, and there are kids who are still being molested. Right. We're not done. And because we knew we weren't done when we finished our documentary, we didn't end on a happy note. The film kind of leaves you hanging. It's like, well, what comes next? Right. Oh, my God. You know, almost and a lot of people are on the verge of tears. The documentary was also not only helpful for guys who have been abused, but for people who go, something's wrong with this guy. Something's wrong with our son, with our daughter, with our husband, with our, you know. Also, it's been very helpful for a lot of women who have watched it, who said to me, you know, Dr. Braben, I am a woman, not a guy, but I watched your documentary and it reminded me I need to work on my abuse, of my molestation. So we meant it as a gift to the world, and that's how we have distributed it, and always free, never charged for the film.
Where is it that people can find it? I mean, as long as we're talking about the film right now.
That's unfortunately a problem. That we had a little problem with the copywriting with the filmmakers, and they did try to sell a different version of it on the internet for a while. And so if people just Google it, they probably will find it. The only way you can really get the original copy is by asking me for it, and I will send a free copy to anybody. And I know that you may have thousands and thousands of listeners here, and it may overwhelm. Well, but also you have a copy, you're free to give it. Anybody who has it can
share it. Okay, that's good to know.
But if anybody wants to reach out to me at any time, you can go through our website, which is, of course, www.isgcmonterey.net. And that's ISGC as in Intimacy, Sexuality, and Gender Center. And because we started that business name in Monterey, we're now ISGC of California, but we keep that web address.
Right. And I'll put that in the show notes so people will have a direct link for your website.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So you asked about myths. In the documentary, we address the seven biggest myths about male sexual victimization. And if it's okay, I'll run through them real quickly.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So the first myth we usually talk about is the macho image myth that boys cannot be abused.
Yeah.
In our society, and I would guess probably in lots of other parts of the world, but I know America. This is the only place I've lived. It's the only place I work. Okay. So in America, at least, we raised boys from the very beginning to believe they're tough.
Yeah.
That if a terrorist came on the plane, a man would stand up and rush him, thinking bullets can't harm me. I'm tough. I can't be abused. When I've talked to young boys about this, kids, when I talk in classes, you know, with elementary school age children about this, and I say, you know, let's talk about boys being abused. Or just kids being abused. Always a hand goes up. I can't be abused. And I say, oh, really? Why? And this little teeny kid will tell me, well, if somebody tried to touch me, I'd just give him a karate chop.
Yeah.
And I ask him, do you know karate? Of course not.
Right. Okay. Right.
One of the myths is that a man is tough from the moment he's born, and he cannot be abused because of that. And the other part of that macho image myth is that if a boy was abused, he doesn't need help because us men just swallow it down, tough it out. I think the term that best fits is man up. Just man up and take it and don't worry about it and you'll get over. Unfortunately, it doesn't pass.
Right.
Another myth about this is that if the boy was molested by a male, it must be because the boy is gay. Mm-hmm. Or somehow effeminate. And this is a very damaging myth, too, because then guys start questioning their sexual orientation. And if they're gay, that's fine. But if they are gay, they might think they'd became gay. Because
right, it
of
made
this.
Them gay somehow, right? That must it be part made of the them belief. Gay. Yeah.
And we know you can't make somebody gay. You can't make somebody straight.
Right.
You can make them have sex with a specific person. You can force sex on somebody. One of the topics, kind of a sidebar with this, that we discuss in the group is the fact that it's a phenomenon that was called the Semen Warriors of New Guinea. New Guinea, prior to a world war where Americans came and built a landing strip and destroyed their culture, was a warrior culture. And at a young age, the boys went to live with the men, the girls went to live with the women, coming together for rituals and food and things like that. But they basically lived apart. And the proud warrior men would pass their proud, strong warrior abilities onto the boys by having the boys perform oral sex on them and swallow the semen.
Mm.
Okay. Does that mean this entire culture was gay? Right. No.
Yeah.
Does that mean everybody had male on male sex? Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
So this issue that you must have been gay for the man to molest you is false on that point, but it's also false on that most people who molest kids are not gay.
Yeah.
Most guys who molest boys are not doing it because they're sexually attracted to men. It's because they're sexually attracted to children.
Right.
And it's a power thing. And
yeah.
The boy is a convenient tool for their sexual desires. It has nothing to do with being gay.
Okay. I do one little question, though. My belief, and maybe I'm wrong, is that a pedophile normally prefers either little girls or little boys. They're not, are they abusing equally, or am I misguided in that thought?
That is true that the pedophiles can have a preference. But I think this is something else we talk about, is what's the difference between a pedophile and a child molester? Most people who are molested as children are not molested by a pedophile.
Yeah.
A pedophile sees children as their sexual orientation.
Right.
They're oriented towards children. They live and breathe to molest children. On the average in America, when we catch a pedophile, put them on trial and sentence them, they've molested at least 117 children.
Whoa. Wow.
However, the average person who's been sexually abused as a child is abused by their mother, their father, their brother, their cousin, their school teacher, their priest, their coach. And typically, these people only molest one, two, maybe three children. Not to say that that's nothing. I mean, of course,
right,
that's
right,
terrible
right, right.
in itself. But
these people have sexual attraction to other adults. I mean, it's not
that's
their...
Right.
Right.
That's right. They're oriented towards adults. But let's say you or I happen to be in a terrible storm, power goes out, the building's collapsing, we get drunk or high, and we're alone with a child, and we're not thinking, and we get out of control, and we do something we shouldn't do. That's a child molester.
Right.
Child molester. Very different than a career pedophile.
Right.
In our documentary, incidentally, we address this, and we show the storefront of NAMBLA, North American Male Love Boy Association.
Yeah.
This is a pedophilic group that exists solely to share information on how to get boys, how to molest them. And their motto is sex by 8 is too late. They
oh my gosh.
Think that they are more evolved than you and I, that they know better, that children are supposed to be sexual. It is our adult obligation to initiate sex with children before they're 8 years old.
Wow.
Otherwise, we're not doing our job. Yeah, those are pedophiles.
Right, right.
So another myth about this is that if a boy was molested by a female, that first, he can't be. How could a boy be? You have to have an erection to have intercourse, is what they think. Well, just because you have an erection and just because you have intercourse with somebody doesn't mean it wasn't child molestation.
Yeah.
But also, there's lots of ways to molest a child. So if a woman fondles a child, that's sexual molestation.
Mm-hmm.
If a woman gives a boy a blowjob, that's sexual molestation. If a woman encourages a boy to suck on her breast, that's sex. There are tons of ways of doing it.
Right.
But this also is a myth because the belief is you can't be molested because you're a guy, you're stronger, you're bigger, you're smarter, how could a woman overpower you? And again, we know that most child molestations occur by people that the child trusts mm-hmm. or is supposed to trust, and it's done in a supposedly nice, loving fashion. So why would a boy try to overpower? Something that I've become kind of a national expert on is what happens when a teen boy gets molested by his female school teacher.
Yeah.
This is an interesting twist on this because quite often it's the football champ of the high school. It's the soccer champ, some real smart kid. And what happens is the teacher falls in love with the boy and thinks somehow it's okay because she doesn't molest other kids. This is just, she's fallen in love with this
boy.
Right. And the boy thinks, well, hey, I'm a teenager. I like women. This is great. I get to do Mrs. Jones, you know, and she's hot. And if he shares it with his buddy friends, most of them will go, oh, cool. You're the man.
You're lucky, right?
Yeah. You're lucky. So he thinks he's lucky. If the girls find out in school, they'll think he's a creep though.
Yeah.
And if the teacher gets caught, and gets either fired or sent to jail or prison, something happens, his boyfriends are going to be mad at him now because they think he ruined their chance of getting with this one. All right. Well, what happens to this guy? He thought he was lucky. Well, guys like that, when they grow up, they develop symptoms too. We haven't touched on the symptoms yet.
Right.
But I'll mention real quickly, one symptom is the belief that sexual rules and regulations, society's morals and values don't apply to him. The message is, yeah, it's not okay to have sex with children, but we were an exception. It's okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Hey, we're taking a real quick break here in the middle of the podcast, and I want to share with you a free resource. If you are in a relationship where sexual desire has been an issue, where one of you wants more sex than the other, where one of you or both of you are struggling to feel desire for sex, this is the training for you. It's a free webinar that you can watch on demand. It's called How to Want Sex More, or Help Your Partner To, without feeling pressure or obligation. In it, I cover the 5 biggest mistakes that keep people stuck, blocked from their sexual desire, and it's going to give you ways to approach this differently to start to create a sex life that's really fun and easy for both people. You can sign up at intimacywithease.com/masterclass.
So the vampire myth is one that I mentioned again that is really, really important and damaging. These are the top myths about male sexual victimization that we really have to address. Another one is, as I mentioned a little bit, but I'll reiterate, is that if a man molests a boy, the man must be gay. And that is not true whatsoever.
Right.
Absolutely
right.
Not true. So when people hear these myths and they believe it, a lot of guys won't have children. They won't put themselves in a position where they can have children.
Yeah.
They won't become school teachers because they're afraid themselves that they might go on and molest. Also, let's say a guy meets a beautiful young lady and they fall in love and say, we're going to get married and have children. And he goes, well, there's something I should tell you before we get married. I was molested as a kid. Good possibility that woman will call it off.
Yeah.
Out of that fear, you're going to molest our children.
Yeah, I'm sitting here thinking, you know, there's the myths, how damaging it is that we in society have these myths, and then what a burden is on the actual victims to carry these myths too, you know?
Yes.
Double-edged sword there.
Very much double-edged sword.
Yeah.
So as far as carrying it goes, some of the symptoms of a male who's been sexually victimized as a child are similar to the ones that we would expect in a woman who's been sexually abused, or if somebody's transgendered in any way, shape, or form, there are some common ones.
Okay.
A cornerstone symptom is disassociation. People disassociate from their body, they disassociate from reality, they disassociate from relationships, a lot of disassociation. Sexual shutting down is a real common one too. Now, this is though where a woman and a man might differ in how that plays out. Most women who have been sexually abused will shut down sexually completely if mm-hmm. they shut down. Men, they may shut down completely, but a lot of guys, what they do is they shut down with their primary partner, but they go and act out sexually somewhere else. Mm. Of course, if it comes out, they're labeled as a sex addict. People don't understand what's wrong with you. Why would you do this kind of thing? But we can see the mindset here, how this plays out very easily. People who have been sexually abused try to squash it from their mind. They try to set it aside. And the excitement of a brand new relationship, the infatuation, the, oh, I'm in love, makes sex with this new person easy. Okay, I can do this. About 2 years into the relationship, and that 2-year mark is really significant. About 2 years into the relationship, when they feel like they should now really trust this person and have a real good bond, and they're being supposed to be sexual with them, it triggers the memory of the fact that most of them were molested by somebody they should have trusted, yeah. should have had a good close bond with. And so it screws it up in his mind. So it's better to shut down sex with that person. It becomes unsafe.
Yeah.
But you could still go have sex with a prostitute or masturbate like crazy or somehow act it out, because that's different. That right. is new. It doesn't bring up those buttons.
Yeah.
That's a real important one. Another one that we see more in men, we see this in women too, but we see this far more in men, is that they definitely get into splitting behaviors of all or nothing, black or white, good or bad, yes or no. And for men, it really plays out in the, I'm a complete loser failure. Mm. I can't keep a job. I can't keep a relationship. I'm drug addicted. I'm alcoholic. I'm every way to show and prove to life that they are trash and they don't deserve anything good. They're horrible. Or they're major overachievers. Hmm. Maybe they become president of the United States. Okay? There was a lot of talk, belief that Bill Clinton, because he was abused as a child, that maybe he was sexually abused. Huh. No evidence ever came out about that. He never said anything. But imagine if you become president of the United States, that's pretty overachieving for yeah. most people.
Right. Yeah.
So a lot of the patients that I work with, find that if they run big CEO, they're the CEO of some big company and they're always working, so they don't have time to really attend their child's birthday party.
Yeah.
They don't have time. It's a way of avoiding. It's a way of splitting. And so they see that in other people. Something else too that's interesting about men is it doesn't matter if they were molested by men or women or transgendered people. Across the board, they won't trust men when they become adults.
Oh.
So the guy who comes into my group because he was molested by the male priest when he was young is just as likely to distrust men as the guy who comes in whose grandmother molested him when he was young. Hmm. They have a lot of major trust issues.
Yeah.
And because they're men, men try to fix things. They want things done now, fast. So they don't understand why carrying this for 30 years, why can't they just have 2 or 3 sessions and get it over with? The women's groups at their rape crisis centers tend to run 16 weeks. Women figure once a victim, always a victim. I'm going to be here for the long haul. Men want to get in there and get it over with.
Yeah.
So we have to use other kinds of methods working with men. Definitely other methods. Regardless, and I'll switch over to this right now, regardless whether it's a male, female, transgendered person, I very strongly take a psychoeducational approach to working with them. Because if you were raped as an adult and nothing else happened to you before, the goal is to quickly get back to where you were. You yeah. know how to be an adult. You just have to reclaim your sense of safety. If you were molested as a kid, you lost out on childhood. Or piece of your childhood.
Yeah.
And you don't know how to do adult mature relationships. We say that kids are developmentally arrested at the stage that they are molested. Mm. So one of the things I do in my men's group is I teach play. I teach clown school. I take them to clown school. Essentially, I teach them clown methods to get them to laugh. I teach them to laugh, to play, to trust other men. So we do a little bit of typical male bonding stuff. I have them stand up, hold hands, and honk something I plagiarized from a thing called Lessons from Geese, that geese don't molest each other. They stand up for each other. They take turns taking leadership. And as I heard the military march by my office one day, I got an idea. So the guys literally hold hands and they go, honk, 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 and see who can be the loudest or the longest. It's a bonding thing.
Yeah.
But another one is I have them touch in a safe way, in that I have them hold hands facing each other, shaking hands for a prolonged period with each guy as I walk them through some breathing exercise or something like that, because they need to be able to learn it's safe to talk to men. It's safe to be with men. It's safe to have a appropriate touch, a handshake. Don't really teach hug anymore. Used to be a hug therapist, you know, teaching hugs, and then we got in trouble for too much hugging and okay, you know, don't touch people. But we definitely do different methods. And I'm a firm believer that men have to take action to heal. So what does that mean? For a lot of them, they go out to the junkyard together and they beat up old cars and scream and yell and let their anger out that way. Other ways, though, they have to confront the perpetrator, or they have to confront somebody who didn't protect them.
Yeah. Does this have to be confront in real life? Can it be confront in their imagination, or write some letter they never send?
Like, that's a very good question. And they ask me all that all the time. It depends on the person. Mm-hmm. For some people, yes, they need to go confront the perpetrator in real life, in real time. Some people, it's write a letter to somebody who's passed away.
Yeah.
So, and maybe take it to the ocean and burn it and set it out on the ocean. Another way of confronting, though, is to confront child sexual abuse. So at the Rape Crisis Center, we have an annual foot race every year as a fundraiser. A lot of my patients would come out and either run the race or help me pass out T-shirts or something. We used to sell wristbands for the Rape Crisis Center at my table at the farmer's market. They'd come help do that. I tell them, you got to do something. Maybe it's teach children a song about child molestation and how to protect their body. A colleague named Peter Alsop, educational psychologist, he writes a lot of children's music, does children's workshops, performs, and all of his music is therapeutic in nature. So he has a song for Christmas. All I want for Christmas is mommy to stop smoking. Okay. Well, he's got a song called My Body, and it's about my body's mine. You have your body. Let me, you know, my body's fun. It can be this, that. But don't touch my body. You don't have a right to touch me. And it's done in a fun way. So if somebody goes home and teaches that to their kids, they're making a confrontation.
Yeah.
They're confronting the issue of abuse. If a man goes to a woman's march, Me Too Woman's March, he's confronting sexual abuse.
Yeah, and I would imagine participating in your documentary was confronting, and even showing up, even showing up in a group and telling your story. You know,
It's very, very hard. Most guys who have been sexually abused never come forward for help. And a little knowledge about how prevalent is this: we use the number 2 out of 6.
Okay?
Wow. We think that maybe about 18% of all males were molested in some way, shape, or form by the time they were 18. Maybe. We don't have good numbers because lots of guys don't come forward and tell us.
Yeah.
But when the guys do come forward, and then we can extrapolate, well, how many people saw that priest? How many people had that mother? And how many people don't come, and what took them? We find it's very rare. So in America, one of the reasons why my group is so rare is, first, it's been happening since 1994. So it's a very long running group.
Right.
But to the best of our knowledge, there's only about 40 of these kinds of groups anywhere in the world.
Really?
Now, here in California, where I live, I know of one in San Diego and one in San Francisco.
Okay.
Sometimes there's one in Santa Cruz. Sometimes. Okay. But so if we have maybe 2 or 3 in California, and there's only 40 in the world,
yeah,
the numbers, there's states in the United States that don't have a group like this.
Wow.
And why? Well, part of it is getting the word out to men, getting them to believe that to recognize what happened to me is called rape, is called child molestation, and to understand they need to come for and help. But another part is getting therapists to do these kinds of groups, to do this kind of work. I've lectured all over the country. I've been at conferences like crazy, giving out these documentaries. We used to give them out on DVDs. And I've encouraged people to start these groups, and people go, thank you for doing this work. It's so important. Wow, it's so awesome. I said, do you want to do a group like this? No.
How important is it, do you think, that a group like that is led by a man?
Excellent question. So years ago, one of my colleagues, Dr. Vina Blanchard, down in Los Angeles, saw me present, and she asked that question. And I said, well, you know, considering how rare these groups are, most guys would probably be willing to have it run by a woman than not have it at all.
Yeah.
And so she decided to fly up to Monterey once a week for a year, train with me. And then she started the first, and at that point, the only group like this in all of the Los Angeles basin.
Wow.
And it was very successful. Yeah. It doesn't matter that much. A lot of times, you know, female patients come to me and they say, don't you have a woman I can work with? Sometimes I do. I have a female intern. Sometimes I don't. But it's like, you know, it's not about that. It's about being there for them, understanding the issue, being able to connect. And most of the time, then women will accept me as their therapist. Well, it's the same thing. Most guys will accept a female therapist, partly too, because 80% of therapists are women.
Right, right.
So if you're not going to go see a woman, hello, in this town, you don't get a therapist then.
Right, right.
Yeah. So I'd like to mention too, though, I said that, you know, this topic comes and goes.
Mm-hmm.
And as now we're starting to maybe see the light at the end of the tunnel of COVID, which incidentally has been very bad for child molestation issues, because yeah, kids have been stuck at home with parents, parents stuck in the stress, the anxiety, and of all this, you know, sheltering in place. And kids who got abused more.
Right, right.
But this issue is not done. I mentioned that in April, the International Society for Sexual Medicine is having a special webinar on child sexual abuse in men. And I'm going to be moderating that webinar. It's out of Denmark, but it'll be broadcast throughout the world. We need these things to come up periodically until we're done.
Yeah.
People have asked me, well, you've done so much in this field, why don't you stop? Well, we're not done with the issue.
Yeah.
You know, we've made a lot of progress, but we don't see an end to child molestation. And we don't see it that, oh, all of a sudden, because Stephen Braveman made a documentary, now nobody's going to molest a boy again. You know, it's just not realistic.
Yeah.
So until we're done with the issue, we have to keep bringing it back up. And as I mentioned earlier, it's an issue that gets dropped. Let me take it to the couples level too.
Yeah, yeah. That was what I was going to ask you next. So what is it? Uh-huh. If somebody's in a relationship with the man, or the man is in this relationship, has this history of abuse, what does a couple do?
Well, so the progression usually is, let's start with some individual therapy and then see if the guy can get ready and come into the men's group. Okay? In the men's group, usually they're there for about a year and a half to 2 years. And in the men's group, they make a lot of progress. I'm usually the first one to notice the progress. The other men in the group are next ones to notice the progress. The man's partner at home is the last one to notice the progress.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's very hard to bring that home and show it and change it. So part of what I do is I lead weekend workshops called Outgrowing the Pain Together, which is for a sexual abuse survivor and their partner. One of them or both of them have to be a sexual abuse survivor. And we bring them together so that the couples can meet other couples who are going through this and they can bounce it off. So it's very helpful, especially during breakaway session, where I'll take everybody who identifies as the partner of come on in this room. Everybody who's a survivor, stay in this room. Okay? And in the breakaway for the partners, they say, well, you know, my husband or my boyfriend does this. And the other people go, oh, mine too, too. And they, oh, my God, it's not me.
Yeah.
And they, or they'll share, God, I feel so guilty. Like, I don't know what to do. And I think I should be able to fix this. Especially, you know, women think if you give a man a love, you can fix him.
Right, right.
That doesn't happen. So they bounce that off, and that's really helpful. Another thing I offer is tantra intimacy, sacred intimacy weekend workshops for sexual abuse survivors and their partners. This is where we use the ancient traditions of Tantra, working with the chakras, working with breath, working with eye contact, working with energy to help the people heal and find safe bonding. A major difference between that workshop and a generic Tantra workshop is we focus far more on permission, asking permission, getting permission, and safety before anything happens.
Yeah.
So in a typical Tantra workshop, couples are told, okay, face each other. Now put your right hand on each other's hearts. And a lot of people can't handle that. So
right.
In our workshop, we'll talk about, okay, ask first. May I put my right hand on your heart? May I hold you? May I touch you? And teaching that permission and safety. And that really, really helps the couple move to a different level. Also, we have to break their sexual maps, because couples usually come in there having sexual problems. Either it's their sexual behavior is completely shut down, their sex life completely shut down, or they're having real difficulty with it.
Yeah.
Guys in particular, I'll back up just for a moment. One of the techniques I teach men is that they have to masturbate differently, because a man's map usually is you get alone, you find whatever you know triggers your sexual excitement, pornography or a fantasy or a chat with somebody. Yeah, get to your penis as quickly as you can. You get over as quickly as you can. And well, was that healing? Was that loving? Was that kind? Was that safe? Was that? No,
right.
I was just jerking off and getting off.
Yeah.
So I teach them to start with masturbation, to do what is more typical of females, is to have a sexual romantic date with yourself and to make it full body experience. We know as men age anyways, they need to stop focusing so much on just their penis, and they need to become more experienced and full body focused to enjoy sex. So why not start now?
Right.
So with the couple, they have their pattern too that they develop. Typical pattern. What? You know, it's okay, it's Friday night.
Friday night,
we'll
let's
have a
go
glass
upstairs.
Of wine, go upstairs. And one of the things that sexual abuse survivors do a lot of is they disassociate during sex.
Right.
This is too re-stimulating. So I teach them to maybe stop, open their eyes, ask their partner to stop, ask their partner to look at them. Please look at me. Let's breathe together. Remind me that you are not my mother. Remind me you are not my father. Remind me that you love me. Let's reconnect. And then we can go about whatever we were doing again. But they need to learn those techniques. The Tantra workshops really help them learn those other ways of connecting. And I tell them, look, do you have to do this for the rest of your life? No. But while you're healing, let's change these patterns. Some of this you may want to do for the rest of your lives.
Yeah.
But at least for now, you need that extra level of safety in sex. I'm a firm believer that sexual abuse requires sexual healing to finish your healing from sexual abuse, which means a safe, good, satisfying sexual experience.
It makes me think of what you were saying about your development being arrested at the age you got molested, that one of the things that would have been interrupted would be a fully healthy sexual development. You know, how do you relate with a sexual partner and connect and pleasure and communicate and all those things? And that there would likely be a barrier for somebody who'd been abused.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
And I do want to mention one other piece here is that I've talked a little bit about transgendered people.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a gender specialist. And so one of the things I did years ago, to the best of my knowledge, at least the first one to do this, is I brought trans men into my men's groups. Because it's important to understand that if somebody identifies as a male now, he probably identified as a male back then, but was female bodied. And so the child molester or rapist was raping this person, thinking they're molesting, raping a female. And it's hard enough to be in a female body if you identify as a male. Now, of course, we can reverse this too.
Yeah, right.
If you're a trans woman and, you know, but we're talking about my men's group. So at first, when I did that, the Rape Crisis Center was challenged by it. Some of the men were challenged. It's like, you're bringing in a transgendered person? Yes, yeah. You're a person. This is a guy.
Yeah.
And he was molested as a kid. So, but we do need to do a little extra healing with those kinds of patients because of that extra layer of, ooh, I was in the wrong body. And what does this mean? And quite often they may have to look at, are they transgendered because they were molested? This is that old, oh, let's go back. Aren't all lesbians women who were raped by men? No,
right,
absolutely right. Not. This has nothing to do with it. But it's easy for me to say that. It's easy for you to go, yeah, right. But it's not so easy for the person who's living that experience to really get that.
Well, it seems like the same way being molested doesn't make you gay. It doesn't make you trans either, right?
Doesn't make you anything other than a survivor of sexual abuse.
Yeah.
Incidentally, language too is that we sometimes say AMAC, adult molested as a child. We may say a sexual abuse survivor. Sometimes people don't like the term survivor. But certainly, people don't like to be labeled victim.
Right.
But sometimes we have to start, yes, you were a victim. Let's do a reality check.
It was done to you. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
And it was against the law and it was wrong.
Yeah.
And it was hurtful. So now you survived it. So now we'll call you a survivor. And what we aim towards is thriver. So people say, well, do you ever get over it? Yes. Does that mean we take it out of your history? No.
Right.
Absolutely not. I got in trouble when I was a kid because I stole maybe candy from a store. Did that make me a criminal? Well, at the time, I guess so. But, you know, am I still a criminal? No. Did I get over it? Yes. Yeah. So yes, people can move beyond these things. Yeah. Help and healing is available. And that's the message I want to
give. I'm just going to ask you that. What if there was one message you were going to leave people with after this conversation? Help and healing is available. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. That message has to come with the one message before it. On this topic, yes, boys do get molested. Not all, but yes, it does happen to boys. Yes, it does affect them when they're men. And then help and healing is available. Our public service announcement we made was called You Are Not Alone.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of it, I'm seen at a grease board circling a thing that says you are not alone. Help and healing is available. You are not alone.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much for talking to me today and sharing this. I think it's just so important.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
You've been listening to Better Sex. Please visit our website, bettersexpodcast.com, for show notes and additional episodes.
And that's a wrap for today. I really hope you enjoyed the episode. If you are enjoying the podcast, if some of this material resonates with you and you would like to make a difference and make sure that this keeps coming out in the world once a week, ongoing, there are a couple things you could do to show your appreciation. The first would be to go to iTunes and rate and review the show. That really helps us be found by new listeners when you review the show on iTunes. You can find a link at bettersexpodcast.com/iTunes. The other thing I want to invite you to consider is becoming a Patreon. For a small monthly pledge, you get some benefits. So for $2 a month, you get advance access to every single episode. For $5 a month, you get a chapter of my upcoming new book. And for $10 a month, I host quarterly get to know you and question and answer chats over the web, and you get invited to that. I would love to have your membership in that. Become part of the Better Sex family. You can find a link at bettersexpodcast.com/Patreon, which is Patreon. Again, thanks for listening. I'm glad you're here. Feel free to comment, ask questions, get in touch. I'd love to hear from listeners. Thanks.